this is the Le Menec alignments. It's the most westerly part of the Carnac alignments. So again, a plateau which we're on here, a flat. This was the first work that was done here, was flattening this out. This was not flat land, so the first thing to have been done was to flatten it out. And then from here, you've got all these massive standing stones which go downhill, 11 rows. They start off the south in this direction. And the Professor Thom measured all the lines here and found exact number of megalithic yards between each line. And I then worked on that and discovered that there was something interesting about the distances involved. Because between the first row and the second row, there are 10 megalithic yards, and then 14 and 14, and then, which makes a total for the first three rows of 38 megalithic yards, 10 plus 14 plus 14. And then we have another row of 14 megalithic yards between them, and then 12 and 12, which makes 12 plus 12 plus 14, another 38 megalithic yards. There are four rows remaining. Four spaces remaining. There are 11 rows, but 10 spaces. And the in the northern part, the rows are closer together, and the four final rows add up to 38 megalithic yards between the four final rows. So it's as if the thing divided into three parts of 38 megalithic yards. But the top part is made up by four rows, which I think was 8, 8, 10 and 12. I think that adds up to 38. And which is very interesting because it's a way of dividing 10. Anyway, I can't get into all this on video, but what you have to realize is that the rows are closer together to the north and then further spaced towards the south, except for the last row, which suddenly has only got 10 megalithic yards between. Okay, now you can see just in front of us three stones which are out of line. These three stones show the east-west axis, and then you can see how they then change direction to go to the major angle of the whole of the lines, which is the triple square. Okay, and you can also see from here, just in front of us, if you get exactly in the spot, right, a little more like that, just here you can see the recumbent stone, which is I call that the table stone. It's the sort of central stone on which all the geometry is done. But behind that, if we zoom, hang on, turn it around a bit. Can we zoom on that? Behind that, you can see a rounded stone and a much higher stone, which is the highest stone in the alignments. That is an alignment which, if you project it, goes right up to the Manio 2 giant on the hilltop. Okay, so that's...
Which is a couple of kilometers away.
Yeah, over 2 kilometers over away, two kilometers. Yeah. So let's bring that out of zoom. There you go.
Fabulous.
Yeah. Okay. I think that Professor Thom actually noticed when he did the plans here was that the angle of the beginning of the lines, if you come around here, and you look down this line, you can see there's a kind of alignment from the first stones there, and that the stones at the beginning, the first stones of each alignment, are not perpendicular to the lines. There's an angle given. They move in this way. And that angle, with respect to north, is the angle of a double square. And Professor Thom actually noticed that. Yeah. You can see how the lines are moving in. They're not aligned, you know, in the same way. Now, here, if we look down this line, we can See, there's a stone which is out of line right in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
You see it there?
Yep.
And that stone there, from the recumbent stone, marks the solstice, summer solstice. So it, attention is attracted to it by the fact that it's out of line. All the others are in line. And from that stone, that's where the sun rises on the longest day of the year, from the central recumbent stone. And that was noticed, that fact was noticed by already in the 19th century by Felix Gaillard, who was a sort of local antiquarian. He noticed that. He used to live here, come here regularly, and he noticed that the summer solstice, that stone, he called it the index stone. He was the first person, really the first person, before Sir Norman Lockyer, the first person to talk about astronomy in the megaliths. They seem to put these nice floors around the... And you can see here some of these stones are escaping from the... They're coming through the fencing. So this is the cromlech at the head of the Menec alignments. You can see how the stones aligned like that and how they're virtually touching. And it's on a curve. You can see how they go round, well, under the tree, and go right round. And in fact, the whole village is built inside. Well, a lot of the village is built inside this cromlech. Yeah. And we'll do a little trip round it, and it that goes right round towards the south, round the village, and then comes back in and is perpendicular to the first part of the alignments. You see the alignments up there.
The first thing you see is this stone.
So the cromlech actually stops here, and people who are used to stone circles in England think that this part has probably been destroyed, but in fact I don't think so, because if you see this stone here, if you look at it closely, it's positioned perpendicularly. You have the stones which have their long face aligned, and you come to this stone and it's placed perpendicularly. These exist in England as well, they're called blocking stones, and they seem to mark the end of the line of stones by putting
like
a perpendicular
bookends.
Like, yeah, like so, bookends. Yeah,
so
exactly.
The other stones don't slip.
Yeah, exactly. Which would mean that this was intentionally the end of the cromlech. Now, something which nobody, virtually nobody knows about, is that these alignments here, which if you throw the gap, you can see, you see the Menec alignments, which we just saw, and these come straight down to this cromlech. But there used to be another series of alignments coming in this direction, coming from Plouanel, from a distance of 4 kilometers away. So the head of those alignments still exists. The stones at the beginning of those alignments are still there because they're the biggest ones. But we have written record from 1847 in a book written in 1847 where it's written, "It is a secret for nobody that over 2,000 standing stones have been destroyed between Plouanel and Carnac." All those alignments were destroyed for building houses, building roads. The government was one of the state were one of the major destroyers. They would take the stones and use them for the road building. It was a time that they were starting to build roads. And so another alignment arrived at another angle here and came into the circle at this point, which is why there's no part of the cromlech here. But all trace of that, well, not all trace, there. If you go along the line, you can still find stones along the lines, but globally, nobody is aware of that. Yeah. So in other words, this cromlech was like a sort of junction. You'd have two lines, 4 kilometers lines, coming in like this, and this kind of circular thing connecting them.
Mm.
All right?
Mm.
And this was a plateau, so this was flattened out first. And if you look at the land behind, you can see that the field behind, I don't know if you can see it with the camera, but the field behind is at least this much lower than here. So the first major work was actually bringing earth and flattening the whole thing, just like to the pyramids, you know, the pyramids. There was a lot of work done to be able to build the pyramids exactly where they were built. I've written another book just about this, but it's a bit more complicated to go into the details, but you can see how it's well preserved, you know, how they're touching. You see how the angles are made like this, so that they sort of fit together. Now, quite a lot of these stones had fallen out because of the difference in land level, because they terraced this part. With the, over the years, the soil creep or whatever, the earth, and quite a few of these stones had fallen over. And so they were re-erected in the 19th century by Felix Gaillard. And every time a stone was re-erected, he put a little red square on here to show that this stone had been re-erected. So if you see that's that and here, you see that all these stones have been re-erected. I've seen the original drawings from 1832 by Blair and Reynolds before any restoration work was done, and there you can quite clearly see how the land goes down and how the stones have fallen out. So they were just re-erected, and it's quite clear that they're in their initial places. They haven't been moved for a long distance. So the restoration work is probably very precise. Of course, some stones have disappeared. Some have never been re-erected. This part of the cromlech has been destroyed, but you can see it here along the wall of this house. If you, well, you can't really see it here. This is that maybe. If you come right in here, look. Remains of the cromlech with the stones like along the wall, and then it turns round and goes through there. Now they've closed this off. We used to walk through here, but that's been closed off now. But the lines continue and go to the other side there. Okay, so that's been sort of made into private property, but we'll go round, and I used to walk through there. But this, in fact, is not part of the cromlech. That's the remains of a dolmen. It used to be here. It's outside the cromlech, and it's southwest of the alignments, exactly like the dolmen at Gamario. See, these are flattened stones, which are lower with a corridor. Okay.